Well, good morning. Glad you guys are here as you make your way in. Today's an exciting day. Hope you are excited to be in the house of the Lord. I know I am as well. I had a lot of misinformation went around midweek. I got a lot of texts saying, hey, praying for you as you deal with COVID. And I always thank you for your prayers. Always thank you for your prayers. Did not have COVID, though, so you just keep praying. I did have bronchitis, a little bit different scenario there. I was COVID tested. I don't know if you guys have experienced that joy yet. I told the nurse as she's shoving these things up into the gray matter of my brain, I told her, I said, we could get people to give up information, sensitive information, and all we'd have to do is COVID test them. That thing's just unreal. But thank you guys for your prayers. We're going to try to make it today. If you see me start hacking again, it was not COVID, pop negative, but it was bronchitis. So just know that I am on the Ricola and I will have water, and that's just part of how today is going to go. But today we're going to talk about prayer. I said last week that prayer is the very most foundational thing that God's asked us to do. And yet it's often something that we don't feel comfortable doing, or we really don't know how to do. And so starting today, it kind of breaks off to a four-week series called Praying Dangerous Prayers, Praying Like It Matters. So we're excited that you're here today as we talk through out of Psalms what it means to be people of prayer and what it means to actually communicate with God and ask Him to begin to break us and begin to search us. So I want to pray just as we get started, and I want to ask the Spirit to come in, and I want to ask Him to have His time in this service. Will you pray with me? Jesus, as we've come into this place, we're going to sing songs about You that we know to be true. With our hearts and souls, we're going to declare Your worth. God, we pray over every facet of our time together. God, the enemy seeks to destroy this moment. So if he can get in our brain, if he can get in our thoughts, if he can get in our heart, then we spend the next 40 minutes thinking through lunch or thinking through this week. But God, we're praying the enemy would have no victory here today, that Your Spirit would be victorious in this moment. So whether people are sitting in this room or they're sitting at their house, they're watching online, however they're consuming this moment, God, I pray that the enemy would have no stronghold, that their minds would be sharp, their Bibles would be open, and their hearts would be receptive. That what we have not today, give us. What we don't know, teach us, and where we need to repent, show us. We praise You for being so faithful to us. We're thankful that You care beyond measure for us. And so, God, we're just asking, as we spend some time with You this morning, God, that You will continue to reveal time and time again Your faithfulness. Thank You for each family represented in this room and watching online. God, we just pray and plead that You would use it for Your glory. In His name we pray, and all God's people said,
amen. Well, good morning. Again, welcome. Welcome those watching online. God is so good. God is good all the time. Let's stand. We serve a wondrous Savior, and what an awesome feeling just to be able to sing praises to Him.
Lord of all creation, of water, earth, and sky, the heavens are Your tabernacle. Glory to the Lord on high. God of wonders beyond our galaxy, You are holy. Universe declares Your majesty. You are holy, holy, Lord of heaven and earth. Lord of heaven and earth. Early in the morning, celebrate the light. As I stumble in the darkness, I will call your name by night. God of wonders beyond our galaxy, you are holy, holy. The universe declares your majesty. You are holy, holy. Lord of heaven and earth,
Lord of heaven and earth,
Lord of heaven and earth. You are holy, holy. Precious Lord, reveal your heart to me. Father, hold me, hold me.
Amen. You may have a seat. At this time, I've asked, we're going to introduce a song to you, and I've asked Kelly to lead us in this. Thank you. And this is a song that has been really just special to me, and just going through, we all face those struggles in our lives where we just need a touch from God. Maybe we're in a situation where God, where are you? Where are you during this time? And maybe we don't understand what's going on in our lives. Maybe we just need a touch from Him. Maybe we've gone through financial struggles. Maybe we've gone through just things in our lives that we should just, God, where are you? And for some, it may be physical. For some, it may be financial. For some, maybe you're going through struggles with your family. And you just need God to touch. And through it all, as a Christian, we've come to realize that no matter what happens, no matter if God is silent in our lives, no matter if God is getting ready to just open the windows of heaven and just pour out His blessing on us, or maybe God is wanting us to go through the fire, no matter what we face, we know that with God, it is well.
Amen.
Quaked before, moved by the sound of His voice. the seas that are shaken and stirred can be calmed and broken for my regard. And through it all, my eyes are on you. And through it all, it is well. And through it well with me. Far be it from me to not believe, even when my eyes can't see. And this mountain that's in front of me will be thrown into the midst of the sea. And through it all, my eyes are on you. And through it all, it is well. It is well. So let go of my soul and trust in Him. The waves and wind still know His name. So let go of my soul and trust in Him. The waves and wind still know. The waves and wind still know His name. The waves and wind still know His name. It is well. My eyes are on you, and through it all, it is well. And through it all, my eyes are on you, and it is well with me.
Amen. Thank you, praise team. Thank you, Kelly. Grab your Bibles. Turn to the Psalms. If you don't know where that is, you're new to the Word, no fear. Grab your Bible. Go to the very center of the book, and it should have you really close to the book of Psalms. And then once you get there, once you find something that says Psalms, go to the 39th or the 139th chapter of Psalms, and you'll find me in verse 23. Last week, we started talking about how in the Word, in Isaiah, God said about his house is that it would be the house of prayer. God said his house was going to be the house of prayer, not the house of going, not the house of doing, not the house of pretending, not the house of giving, not the house of serving. But he said his house would be the house of prayer. You would come into his house in prayer, and then everything else would work its way out. So what he's teaching us is that we would focus our life in prayer, and we would give our hearts over to prayer. And if we could get prayer right, then everything else would follow suit along with it. What I know from walking with Jesus now 16 years is this. I'm a terrible prayer. I'm a terrible prayer. Like, I pray, but I don't feel like I pray good prayers. I pray, but sometimes I feel like my prayers don't make it past the ceiling. I pray, but sometimes I fall asleep. I pray, but sometimes I don't even know if I'm meaning what I'm actually praying. So I had back surgery. You may have heard that. So right before I had back surgery, I got a care package from a couple of my favorite church members. And inside that care package was a Amazon gift card, which if you've ever wondered, what do we get our pastor? Amazon gift card. I love to read. You got to know that about me. I love to read. I read a lot. So the best thing they could have gotten me was they bought me some. I'm into the Mountain Dew Zeros. Those are my new thing, if you don't know that. I'm also into cookies, chocolate chip, no raisins. Don't give me no raisins. They also gave me some, like, the any kind of salty sweet business. I'm all over it. This body was built, you know. Anyway. So inside that basket was this gift card for Amazon. And so I'm like, ooh, goody, like a little kid at Christmas, Amazon.com, right? Pull out the app. I go to my save list. And what I do is I just buy the next three books that are in my cart. I've already got them there. They're already there. I already got a list of things I want to read. And so I buy them. They show up. Once the medication wore off to a point where I could actually read, because I was reading in the beginning, I was like, I've got now, like, I knew I was going to be out 6 weeks. I'm like, that should be six books, easy, easy. The only problem is when you are medicated, reading becomes a little bit more difficult, because you're like, and the Lord said, what page tomorrow? What book? I can't read this, it's upside down. And so once the medicine wore off to the point that I could read, I began to just devour a couple of books. And one of them was written by a guy named Craig Rochelle. He's a pastor at Life Church. And Craig Rochelle wrote a book called Dangerous Prayers. And in his book, Dangerous Prayers, he maps out the reality that most believers in the United States don't ever pray a dangerous prayer. We don't pray dangerous prayers. In the Bible, we find a guy who prays dangerous prayers. In Psalm 139, King David is talking before the Lord, and he begins to pray a dangerous prayer. This is what he says. It's on the screen behind me. It's also in your Bible. He says, in verse 23, he says, "Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me, know my thoughts. See if there's any grievous way in me, and lead me in the way of the everlasting." Jesus, this is your time. I pray that you would be in my body, that you would be in my lungs. God, as bronchitis tries to work its way out and interfere. God, we pray that it would not. Lord, I pray that you would give me discernment to know how to preach, what to say, God, and it would be your message to your people. God, stand in my body, breathe in my lungs. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. So as I'm reading this book by Craig Rochelle, it hits me. Like, he's not just writing to you as some type of parishioner, and I'm at 30,000 feet going, I knew this was a problem. He's writing to me. And I'm reading this book by Craig Rochelle going, I spend so much of my life praying insignificant prayers. We're taught as children, right? We teach our kids to pray. You pray over your food. In fact, we've got about three prayers we kind of rotate through at our house, because if we just go with the same one every time, it becomes a race. Like, my boy, now Dallas is funny. I hope one day you get to watch him pray, because that boy will get in the spirit. I mean, he gets his face just right, and it's all wrinkled up, and he's asking, he's like, God, our Father. He's just getting into it. Caleb, on the other hand, prays more like his daddy did, with fork in hand. You know what I'm talking about? He's waiting on amen. In fact, the fork may be loaded. It may already have a potato on it. Like, he's, amen, he's going. We talk about prayer, and we teach prayers, and my kids know prayers. They know when we go to bed, we talk about praying, and we pray, and when we go over a meal, we're going to say the blessing. And yet, if we're not careful, we assume that, and we wear that as adults, and that becomes our prayer life too, where we spend the bulk of our prayer asking for a Hail Mary, that God would take this double cheeseburger with extra bacon and fries and somehow make it healthy for us. Or we're praying, Lord, I'm going to sleep. Don't let the bad people get me. We begin to pray prayers that aren't actually going to challenge us, that aren't actually going to lend us to spiritual growth, that aren't actually going to change our lives. And as I'm reading Craig Rochelle's book, as I'm praying and meditating in my heart, it kind of hit me. What if that's where most people feel comfortable? What if that's where most people feel comfortable? I'm going to give you five things to write down. These are five ways to play it safe in your prayer life. Five ways to play it safe in your prayer life. If you don't want to advance in your walk with Jesus, you don't want to be challenged, you don't want to see big things out of a big God, then pray these five prayers. The first one is pray empty prayers. Pray empty prayers. You say, well, Jeff, why would you pray an empty prayer? We do it all the time. We do it all the time. When prayer is not something that our heart is in, then it becomes an empty prayer. It becomes an empty gesture. It's not really something our hearts are beating for. So when you sit down and you're having that ritualistic blessing, there's nothing wrong with repetition. There's nothing wrong with saying some type of same prayer over and over again. But if it becomes just something that we're uttering out of our mouth without our heart and our spirit's knowledge, and we're just spewing words, then it's empty. It's empty. It's not going to leave the ceiling. God's not going to hear that, because we're not praying in a way that he would hear. We're not praying in our spirit. We're not focusing in on who God is in our prayer. We are emptily giving our breath over to something else. Second thing, if you're going to play it safe, this is the second prayer that you would pray. Pray self-absorbing prayers. Pray self-absorbing prayers. Self-absorbing prayers. How does this work? If your prayer list looks more like your shopping list, then you're praying self-absorbed prayers. If your prayer list is a, Lord, give me, give me, give me, then you're praying about you to get something and not for God to talk to you. Most of us have failed to realize that prayer is not a declaration, it's a communication. It's not declarating, it's communicating. Lord, here I am. David says, Lord, search me. Know my heart. Know my heart. Lord, search me. They're talking back and forth. Think of the most significant relationship you have with another human being. Maybe it's spouse, child, whatever it is. How neglectful would that relationship be if you gave it 15 seconds before every meal? and maybe 45 seconds before you fell asleep at night. What type of communication? Like, imagine this was my relationship with my wife. Lord, I'm home. Give me some deep. And that was it. I'm going to talk to her again in 3 hours, and it's going to sound just like that. And then right before I go to bed, Kenny, don't let the booger man get me. Amen. And I go to sleep. Like, well, Jeff, you wouldn't say that. But yet, that's often how we're communicating with the God of wonder. Lord, bless my food and don't let bad things happen to me. Is that really all that God's asking us to talk about to him in prayer? Because that's not what David's praying. David didn't pray, bless this. He didn't say, bless my fish. He didn't say, bless these vegetables. He said, Lord, search me. Look inside of me. He wasn't praying self-absorbing prayers. One of the ways that you can know if you're praying self-absorbing prayers is by writing your prayers out. And if your prayers are more, Lord, give me, instead of Lord, thank you, then you're falling into a self-absorbent prayer. We sing a song in Southern Baptist Life, count your many blessings, name them one by one. Count your many blessings, see what God hath done. Count your blessings. I told the first service I wasn't going to sing to you, but I can't help it. Name them one by one. Count your many blessings, see what God hath done. We sing that. We sing that. And if we're not careful, it's a hymn we sing and not a lifestyle that we live. Your prayer needs to be in an exaltation. God, I am blessed. I've got a house that I get to live in. I've got a family that loves me. I have a job that pays the bills. This is real talk, and my body is proof of it, because I believe your actions always speak louder than your words. I rarely worry about where my next meal is coming from. Like if I told you I'm nervous, you guys would be like, no, you're not. You'd look different. Like, we're just blessed beyond measure, and I love, one of the joys of my life is getting to go out of the country on whether vacation or mission trips or wherever. After a week in a third world country, when those airplane wheels hit the tarmac back in the United States of America, there's always a feeling that wells up in me that I know this is the greatest country in the world. I've been to a couple of them now around us, and I can tell you that the only thing that would make that better is if Lee Greenwood was sitting next to me singing God Bless America or, you know, something like that. But when those plane tires hit the tarmac, I know we've got our issues. I know we've got a mess in our country, but I still know this is the greatest place to live in this moment and this season. And I think we need to embrace that and enjoy that and realize we're a lot more alike than we are different. And I think that we can really live that. But I think when we start praying, Lord, thank you for what I have, instead of demanding things you don't have, it's going to change your prayer life. It's going to change how you think about God. Because instead of somebody up in the sky by and by way out yonder, all of a sudden he's a lot closer when you realize he has blessed you. That when you walked in and flipped on your light switch, that you had the money to pay that bill. That you had the job that afforded you the income to pay that bill. That when you go to the refrigerator, and like this is like, we've got kids like this. Right? Open the refrigerator. There's nothing in there. Yes, there is. It may not be what you want. Our kids are just at this weird age. Parents, you're going to have to help me because our kids want to eat because they're bored, not because they're hungry. You tracking with that? Like, and maybe every kid does it, and we're just now at this, like, used to we had, like, make the kids eat. Now they're always hungry. They've got two stomachs. They got a snack stomach and a meal stomach. The snack stomach is 7 times larger than the meal stomach. You got to know that? And we're just frustrated by that. They're like, we want something. And yet, as their parents, we're having to say, look at what all you have. Look at everything you've got. You've got toys on top of toys, top of toys. And we're teaching our kids, be grateful for what you have, because there are people that don't have what you have. Third way to play it safe, continue to pray for your safety and your security. We spend so much energy in our world being safe. So much energy fighting for our security, that we never actually live walking before the Lord, just trusting in him. We spend so much time praying, Lord, keep me safe. Let us be secure. And what we're really saying, Lord, I don't want to feel any pain, and I don't want to have any moment where I don't know what's coming next. I don't want to feel it, and I don't want to be uncomfortable. We got to stop praying for our safety. Now, I'll be honest with you. Are there moments Jeff prays for safety? Yes, there are. It normally happens at 2:30 in the morning. I've got a bobcat around our place. He will get on the back porch. I've got a couple of pictures of him on my security cameras. And there are moments when at 2:30 in the morning, when you hear something fall off the banister on your back deck. I live in the woods. Like, if you came to my house, you got there because you were coming to my house. You didn't just wander past it, okay? And there's moments in the middle of the night, because it always echoes, doesn't it? Like, the middle of the night, like, the smallest of thing, and you're like, what is that? We watch a lot of, like, murder mystery. You got to know that about us, too. So that doesn't help at all. And so, like, I roll over. I grab my phone. Why do I grab my phone? Because that's where my cameras are. Open the app, and now I'm searching. I know where the guns are. I know where the ammo is. I can get it all pretty quick, right? And, like, in that moment, I may utter a prayer. Lord, get them. I don't even know what it is. Get them. The vengeance is yours, Lord. Go get them. And you look, and it's like, oh, our neighbor's cat's back. It knocked over the tongs off the grill. Something like that. There's nothing wrong with praying for safety and security unless it gets to the point where you actually never do anything. You actually never take progressive steps in your faith because you're playing it safe and secure. I think one of the most amazing stories in the Bible, there's these three Hebrew kids who refuse to bow to a king's tyranny. And the king comes before him and says, you're going to bow before me, or I'm going to throw you in a furnace that the second you go in it, you're done. And you see these teenage boys having this conversation. And in their conversation and in their prayers, they never one time say, Lord, keep me safe. They never one time said, Lord, keep us secure. They never one time said, Lord, don't let it hurt. They never one time said, Lord, what if we don't know what's coming next? Their only prayer was, if you throw us in the fire, if God doesn't show up, it's okay. If I suffer right here for just a minute, it's going to be okay because I know what's greater for me. And it's bigger than this world. It's bigger than you, King. So he says, even if, King Nebuchadnezzar, even if God doesn't show up in the midst of the fire, I'm going to be okay. And if you need to back into that story, God showed up and the king got really perplexed. He said, didn't we throw three? Why is there four? And one of them looks like the Son of Man. Anyway, number four, we're going to keep it safe, play it safe in our life. You have to pray not to be involved. Don't be involved. I don't want to be involved. We never would admit that, right? We would never say, well, I'm praying not to get involved. We'd never say that. But let me tell you how that normally comes across. Lord, send somebody. Lord, raise up somebody else. Lord, get Joe to go over and do that. Lord, raise up a generation, Lord. When we need to be praying, Lord, here am I. Send me. Here am I. I don't have all the answers, Lord. I don't have all the qualifications. I don't have all of the resources. But here's what I got. And I'm placing it in your hand for your glory. Use me. Number five, pray for God to never search you. You play it safe. You play it easy. Just pass through this life in the sweet by and by. Pray that the Lord never searches you. Because asking God to search you is dangerous. David is telling the Lord, search me and know my heart. Search me and know my heart. You see, we like to dress it up. This morning I got dressed. I went in the closet and I picked out this shirt and I picked out my suit, put on some fresh socks. That way, in case something happened, you can see that I've got style even in my sock game. I look in this mirror that we've got in our hallway and I went, wow, that's good looking. And we all do that, right? Y'all every morning look in the mirror and say, you good looking, so don't you ever die, right? We'll get the exterior so cleaned up and pristine, but we're never really worried about the interior. And yet David's prayer isn't make sure my socks and my shoes and my belt all match. David is saying, search me, O God, and know my heart. Know that which is on the interior, that can cause so much more damage to the structure than anything on the exterior. Know my heart. Know my heart. So asking God to search you becomes dangerous, because if you ask, he will. If you ask, he's going to search your heart. He's going to begin to do some things that you may not be entirely ready for. So I think God does two things when we begin to ask him to search us. I believe the first thing that God does is God reveals things to you that you may not want to see. Because let's be honest, we all think we're pretty good people. Like, we're good people. Well, we're good people. I get so many people when I'm talking to them about Jesus, like, well, Pastor, ease up now. I'm a good person. And I'm like, well, please, pray tell. Pray tell. What defines you as a good person? And I always get this. I always get this. I never killed nobody. Let the balloons fall. He's good. Like, is that it? That's the measure? That's the measure of good and bad? I've never killed anybody? Did you steal something? What, yeah. You ever cheated? Yeah. You ever told a lie? Yeah. You ever sped in your car? Yeah. You ever fudged something on your taxes? Yeah. How do you know? Because you're bad. You're awful. Because in our own nature, in our own existence, we're prone to sin. We're prone to leave the God who has given us everything. God will begin to reveal some things about you that you didn't want to see. And all of a sudden, when we look in the mirror and see that we've spent more time on the exterior than we have on the interior, we'll see some things we don't like. We'll see some things that we don't like. And now, once God has shown us this, we've got to begin to deal with it. What he will show you is a couple of things. First was this. He'll show you that his will for your life may be different from your will for your life. Think back to when you were a kid. If somebody came up to the fourth grade version of you and said, what do you want to be when you grow up? What would you have said? Doctor, lawyer. What would you have said? I know what mine was. I want to be G.I. Joe. Right? We all had great aspirations, but then life happens, and I don't know if you know this, I'm not G.I. Joe. I never thought, like, listen, let me help you. Fourth grade Jeff would have never gave the answer that in 20-something years I'm going to be pastoring a church in Pinson. Never was in, that wasn't in my scope. We all have hopes and dreams and aspirations. But what happens when God's plan and our plan take different turns? When we begin to pray, Lord, search me, what the Lord's going to do is he's actually going to do that. And he may reveal to you, you've been chasing after the wrong thing. You've been spending so much time, so much energy, and so much effort pursuing something that I've never given you to pursue. You've wasted a life. But don't worry, it's not too late. It's never too late to correct and realize I'm going to follow after Jesus. Number two, he may show you the sins that keep you from him. He may show you the sins. When you begin to pray, Lord, search me and know my heart. Search me and know my heart. He may begin to reveal some sin in your life that you're not confessing. And it may be even sins that right now you're even unaware of. You've sinned. You didn't even know you had sinned, but the Lord's going to reveal that to you so you can deal with it. So he's going to reveal that, but he may get into some deep-rooted stuff. He may get into some deep stuff that begins to break you as you process it. He may show you what's keeping you from me, because we have to remember that God is holy and God is perfect and God is good. He's good all the time, and all the time he is good. And what he cannot stand is our sin. What he cannot deal with is our junk. In fact, the evidence that God cannot stand our mess is, the evidence is clear in the picture of the cross, that God was willing to sacrifice his only begotten son, that whoever would believe in him would not perish but have everlasting life. So Jesus went to the cross for your sin so that then you could stand righteous before God. He may show you some sin that's keeping you from him. There's seasons of my life, and pastors are not immune from this. There's seasons in my life when I have prayed and I have not had confidence that my prayers ever escaped the room I was sitting in. But yet God's called me to pray. I think prayer is the central nervous system to what the believer is. Apart from prayer, we never actually realign our lives with the Lord. And I think this happens daily. I think prayer is the very thing in our life that keeps us grounded. It's what's processing, to help you techie kids, it's the daily update that your life needs to stay in tune and in code with the Lord. Prayer is what's going to keep us as we pray, Lord, search me, know my thoughts, know my heart. He's going to do it. See, when we pray and God begins to reveal, he may show us how we've got some toxic things in our lives that are entangling us. We have toxic things in our life that are entangling us. Katie and I have some sweet friends, and they like to go on cleanses all the time. I don't cleanse anything ever. That's not my thing. I don't do cleanses, but like they'll go like 30 days and won't eat anything but like flaxseed and pecans. That's not my life. I know I got to go from one thing, and I'm hoping heart attacks it. Selfish prayer of mine, I know. But I'm just not a big cleanse person. I don't like that. I used to go when I was in college. We had this huge sportsplex right next to our campus, and I would go. They had like the sweat box, the sauna thing. And I thought, because you're young and dumb, right? We're all afforded that at one point in our life. It's fun to be young and dumb. It's not fun to be old and dumb. So that may help you. So I would go sit in a sweat box for like 45 minutes, and it wasn't working enough. So then me and my best friend, we go get sauna suits, which is just a big huffy garbage bag that you get in, right? And I know I've got sauna suits on, and we're sitting in the sauna, and I'm just pouring sweat out. What I don't know is I'm just losing water. Like I was so, you just don't know what you don't know until you know it. And I'm thinking, I'm losing weight. And finally this guy walks in and goes, what are y'all doing? I'm like, losing weight? He said, dude, you're sweating. I'm like, I know. I was like, it's a weakness leaving the body. He said, no, that's water. Like, he just really, he said, you know, when you drink water, you're going to gain every ounce that you've just lost back. I went, what? What? Like, I thought I was getting rid of toxins, and I thought I could, no, you're just sweating. I mean, yeah, it'll probably clean up the pores a little bit, but you're nasty. Go do something, right? When you begin to pray, the Lord will reveal to you some things in your life that are toxic. I'm going to say something right here, and you may not like it. But many of us are so concerned with politics right now that it's not healthy. It's not healthy. If you're watching wall-to-wall coverage of this election garbage, stop it! You're scaring the kids. My goodness. I'm not telling you don't be concerned about the election. I'm not. I'm not telling you don't vote. You should. You should. There's a lot of men and women who have died in our country who've afforded you the freedom to go cast a vote. Go do that. But stop being so concerned with a party or a person, because that becomes toxic. When all you hear is the frustrating news that comes on. It begins to wear at your soul. I had some students one time, again, young and dumb, love it. Pulled up in the parking lot, and some of you know I can have a smart mouth. Others of you will learn it soon. Kids pull up in the parking lot, and they got the music beating, you know. And I'm like, oh, that's nice. And it's not like the Christian version of that. Like, it's like straight up gangster stuff, and like they open the door, and they're getting out, and it's just like the music coming out of their car. It's like, I feel very uncomfortable as an adult man married at the time. Like, you shouldn't be listening to that. You're like, man, why are you always trying to get all my stuff? They're, you know, they just, all this garbage. And I finally looked at him. I said, dude, what you're consuming will eventually come back out. You can only consume so much trash in your life that the byproduct of such trash becomes trash out. Becomes trash out. So some of you don't believe me. I'm going to help you out. Every once in a while, somebody will gift me an opportunity to go to like one of the meat places, like a Brazilian like smokehouse, you know what I'm talking about, where they just bring meat around your table constantly. You know, y'all tracking with me? Like, there's several around, and like men love those. Women are like, I don't know, the salad's good. I'm like, don't touch lettuce. That's how they get you, right? And so I'll go to, you know, Texas Day, Brazil. And I've turned my card to green. Just bring it to me. Bring me everything but lamb. I don't like lamb. Never liked lamb. Never had it like I liked it. Don't like lamb. Don't bring me steak, right? And so I will consume an unhealthy amount of protein. Unhealthy amount of protein. And my favorite steak they have, man, you've been there. You know what I'm going to say. That garlic ribeye that they bring by, you know it's going to hurt you. You know it. But every time they come by, would you like more? Yes. Yes. And for 4 days after you eat that sirloin, when you sweat, all of a sudden you're like, what is that garlic smell? Because it's oozing out of your pores. Because the trash you consume in will eventually come out. And you and I, when we begin to pray, Lord, search me, God will may begin to show you some of the trash that you're putting into your life, whether it be something you're watching, whether it be something you're eating or drinking or smoking or whatever. It may be something that you are just close to. It may be a relationship that you're in. God will begin to show you the toxicities around you and how they are keeping you from faithfully following after him. So God will reveal some things that you don't want to see. But we serve an amazing God. And God in the Bible, and I love Jeremiah's version of this, and I love Job's version of this. God has always kind of called himself the clay master. Called himself the clay master, and we're his clay. See, when we begin to pray, Lord, search me and know my heart. What God's going to do is he's going to search us and then begin to break us. And that's healthy. It's healthy. Never in the beginning do we ever come back before the Lord and go, thank you, Lord, for crushing my soul. That's not how we often pray. Just like when you were a kid and you were walking out of the wood shop and daddy just wore your rear end out. Like, rarely did you turn around as a kid and go, hey, dad, thank you. Like, that wasn't it. You stomped off to mama thinking she was going to do something about it. Little did we know they're on the same team, right? But as the Lord breaks us down, shows us our junk, shows us our sin, he's not through. His hope for our life isn't that we're a broken puddle sitting at his feet. As he breaks us, he begins to mold us. He begins to mold us. David says, search me, O God, know my heart. Try me, know my thoughts. See if there's any grievous way in me and lead me into the everlastings. We all want to go in the everlastings, but few of us want to go through the search me. We all want to live in the sweet by and by, but few of us want to go through broken at the cross to get there. God will begin to mold your heart into his imago Dei. into His image. He'll begin to mold your heart. Do you know you were created in the image of God? You were created, you. I'm not talking about the person behind you. You and I were created in the Imago Dei, the very image of God. We're the only creature in all of the world created in the Imago Dei. As much as we love Fido, and as much as we love Spot, and as much as we love the cat, whatever you name cats, no matter how much you love your pets, they were not created in the Imago Dei. You were. And I was. We were created in the very image of God. And that means as God breaks us down, He's not going to leave us in a broken state. He's going to begin to mold us back into the image that He has for us. He's going to begin to mold us back into what He desires for us. Job, a man who knew all too well what it meant to be broken, says this, "Your hands fashioned me and made me, and now you have destroyed me altogether. Remember that you have made me like clay, and you will return me to the dust." Lord, I'm just clay. I'm just clay. And you know what I love about clay? I was telling Angelina, she's in art class right now. I hated art in high school. Hated it. The only solace to art class was we got to work with clay. That was it. That was the only fun part. Unless you liked art, then you probably enjoyed more of it. But I enjoyed working with the clay because until you actually killed it, put it in the kiln and fired it, it was always workable. It was always workable. It was never done. You and I are clay. No matter how long we've been walking with Jesus, we're clay. And He's molding us. He's making us more into the image of Him than we were the day before. So I want to give you a couple of takeaways right here. I got four takeaways and I'm done. Four takeaways, I'm done. We'll beat the Methodists out. Number one, as we begin to experience what it means to be molded into the Imago Dei, the first thing we must do is we must trust that the Lord knows what's best for us. We must trust that the Lord knows what's best for us. So many people have such a flawed view of God that He's just up in heaven, He's got His lightning bolt ready, and the first time you mess up, He's getting you with a 95-mile-an-hour fastball. And that's not Him. That's not Him. As we pray and we're broken by God and we want to go into the life of the everlasting, we must know that He knows what's best for us. But that may be different from what you think is best for you. We must trust in Him. We must also rely on His unwavering love towards us. We begin to trust in the Lord. Lord, mold me. Mold me into what You need me to be. So my prayer, Lord, mold me into the pastor that You need me to be to lead Your church. Mold me into the husband that You need to lead my wife. Mold me into the dad that You need me to be to father my children. Mold me into the son that You need to be to reach my parents, to impact my family. Mold me, Lord. We rely on His unwavering love towards us, knowing that the Lord, it's not His desire to hurt us. He says, I'm going to work all things good. All things good. Does that mean, yeah, you may have to hurt to get where we're going? But I'm working it for your good. It may be painful now, but I'm working it for your good later. You may not understand the trial you're walking in right now, but I'm working it for your good. The reason that you're struggling financially now may not be for what you think it is. Maybe I'm preparing you for what's coming next. The reason you're in this relationship now is I'm preparing you for what is next. Know that the Lord is working good. And we can count on His goodness. I don't always have the best track record. You ever failed God? I have. I've prayed that prayer. Lord, I'm not coming back to that feeding trough of sin ever again. And then I close my eyes and blink a couple of times and I'm wallowing right back to the feed trough. But while my track record may not be impeccable, God's is untouchable. So we can lean into his goodness and we can count on it, knowing that he's never failed, he's never lied, he's never had to walk something back, he's never had to come apologize, he's never had to say, oops, I didn't see that coming. God's never had the moment where he said, woo, that surprised us all. He's never had that moment. His track record is impeccable and his goodness is unwavering. And finally this, we can thrive in his amazing grace. So we trust that the Lord knows what's best for us. We rely on his unwavering love towards us. We count on his righteousness and we thrive in his amazing grace. David says, see if there's any grievous ways in me. See, Lord, see if there's any grievous ways in me. Then he says, lead me in the everlasting. Are you walking in the everlasting today? Are you walking in this spirit of you've dealt with God? He's broken you. He's revealed to you. And now you're walking with him better than you were before? We talked last week in Genesis, there's a guy named Enoch in the Bible. Enoch's a weird story and it'll really mess with your theology. The Bible says Enoch walked with God and he was not, for God took him. Genesis, I think it's 25. Enoch walked with God and he was not, for God took him. That's what the Bible says. It's the word of the Lord. Meaning that God and Enoch were talking and praying and enjoying each other's company so much that Enoch did not die. Because when you're reading that, it's such and such live 400 years, he died. Such and such live 400 years, he died. Such and such lived 400 years. And it weren't all 400 years, but you get the picture. It was telling their lineage and their death, but it gets to Enoch and it says, Enoch lived, he walked with God, and he was not, for God took him. That God was so enthroned with the relationship with Enoch that he said, just come up to my house. We can do this all the time. Enoch's in the everlasting. You and I can experience everlasting here on earth where we live life in prayer with the Lord. Live life in communion with the Lord. The Bible says pray without ceasing. But here's what I know. I know we can't pray to a God that we don't believe in. We won't, not for long. We won't give our life and dedicate our hearts over to deep prayer and something that we really don't trust. And I think part of our disposition as American evangelicals is right here. We really don't trust that God is who he says he is. We really don't trust that he really is the great I am. That he really is coming again. You say, well, Jeff, that's an audacious statement. How are you making that? Because our actions don't follow our words. David says, search me, O God. Know my thoughts. Know my heart. If there's any grievous way in me, search me. Have your way with me. My life is yours. I'm your canvas. I'm your mold. I'm yours. He wasn't praying for safety. He was praying big, powerful prayers. How's your prayer life? What is God saying in your heart? What is God saying to you? What is God revealing to you? And what are you going to do with it? Let's pray. Lord Jesus, I pray in this moment, in this season, in this time, as we are reflecting from everything your word tells. Lord, you've told us, you've called us, you've to pray. Say, pray like this. You tell us to pray without ceasing, to come before your throne. You tell us to commune with you. Lord, I believe that you're calling someone right now to pray a different prayer, the prayer of salvation. And somebody right now needs to pray, "Oh, Jesus, I know I'm a sinner, and I need a Savior. I'm asking you to come into my life, to be my God, to be my King. I'm asking you to search me. I'm asking you to know my heart. Search my thoughts. See if there's any grievous way in me that I may live in the life of the everlasting." God, I pray that our hearts would be overcome with prayer, a deep desire to pray, a deep desire to commune, a deep desire to focus in on you and realize that we were created in the Imago Dei. Father, as we dedicate our hearts to prayer, we dedicate our church to being a church of prayer. Lord, I just plead that you would prick our hearts, burden our souls, overwhelm our mind with just who you are. Because I think if we had the same view of you that David did, this wouldn't be so hard. Give us a big view of you and a small view of ourselves. Today, if you're in here and you need to make a decision to follow the Lord, or a decision to join our church, or a decision to confess to the Lord, we want to give you a chance to do that. It's been awkward this year because of COVID, so our invitations have been different, but just in this space, every head bowed and every eye is closed, nobody's looking around. We're just asking you to deal with God. If you're in here today and you say, "Jeff, I just need you to pray over me. My prayer life's not as good as it could be, and I need a better prayer life." If that's you, nobody's looking around. I'm the only one looking. If that's you, slip your hand up real fast, put it back down like a ninja. There you go. Hands up all over the room. I need to be a better prayer. Maybe you're in here today and you say, "Jeff, I'm struggling to pray because I'm struggling with who God is." If that's you, I'm going to ask you to do something audacious. I'm going to ask you just to slip your hand up. I'm not going to hound you down. I'm not going to chase you in the parking lot. I'm not going to tweet you, Instagram you, or Facebook you. I just want to pray over you. If that's you, "Jeff, I'm struggling with prayer because I'm struggling with who God is." Just slip that hand up real fast. Thank you. Thank you. Lord, as we close down this service, we know your Spirit doesn't work on our time clock. We pray for those who are struggling in their prayer life, who know we should pray. Your word tells us we know we should pray, but we find it so difficult. We pray your Spirit would overwhelm us. Like a son running to his dad to tell him about his day would be the type of joy that we would run to you and tell you about ours. Pray that you would search us, know our thoughts. As we leave this place today, may we do so empowered. May we do so built up. May we do so walking out our faith. Thank you for each family here. As they leave this place today, I pray over them. Pray that you would do some incredible work in their life. It's in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit I pray, and all God's people said, amen. We got some ushers going to be at our back two doors in just a second. They're going to take up an offering as you walk out. If you came ready to give, you can do that right there. If you said, "Jeff, I don't carry cash, I don't carry a check," me either. And that's why in the Connect Center, you can give digitally or give with a debit card online. And you can always do that at palmerdalecross.org. This coming Wednesday, we will have a special called Business Meeting. And we'll be discussing a recommendation for the deacons on behalf of our bylaws. And we will be hearing from the leadership development team on a recommendation to fill a vacancy in position. So that's going to happen at 6:15 this coming Wednesday night. That will be a special called event. So that'll be all we discuss in that. And then we'll have some financial stuff and all that stuff to hand out. But we'll go over that in our next business meeting as well. All right. We love you. God loves you. Yeah. Thank you. At the conclusion of this service, you're in a special treat. We've had cool things happen between every service today. We've got the Quicks going to, they are rededicating their marriage to the Lord. They're renewing their vows immediately after this right here. So if you want to hang around for that, for it won't take more than 10, 15 minutes. If Pastor Ryan, it may be an hour, but no, it won't be that long. But we're going to celebrate with that. They've got such a cool story of how God's working in their family. If you want to stick around for that, that would be great. And then if you see Drew Rogers, he's right here in the bright orange shirt. Drew Rogers asked a very special lady to marry him last night. And she said, yes, that's big time. So I'm super excited for him. Thank you for being here. God loves you. I do too. Go and sin no more. Be blessed.